pancreas does is act as an endocrine organ and specifically make insulin and glucagon to control blood sugar. The pancreas empties into the common bile duct and its secretions arrive at the duodenum at the time chyme would be released from the stomach for the purpose of digestion. So we're in liver now, and liver is the multi-lobed structure with the hepatocytes with that kind of hexagonal arrangement of plates of hepatic cells. There is a way to drain bile from those cells. Those cells make the bile, and the bile gets sent also to that common bile duct, as well as to the gallbladder, which we haven't got to. The hepatocytes receive all the blood, all the venous blood coming from the small intestine, and thereby receiving all the absorbed things. So when you're thinking about the GI tract, it seems obvious to say, but you get lost in the weeds sometimes, is just remember there is transit through the system, there's digestion through the system, so you have to have all those components there, and there is absorption and elimination. And what gets eliminated isn't absorbed. And just keep those big functions. I know that sounds so simple, but that's really where I think about what are the big functions you're not confusing. And honestly, this technicals test question seem really has a lot to do with are you getting these big chunks of function? And then it gets worse. But, you know, just keep that in mind. So we're absorbing. We've already digested, absorbed the nutrients from the small intestinal lumen across those columnar absorptive cells. Those nutrients wind up in either the lacteal, and that would be the fatty stuff, or the water-soluble things, or the things that can cross, will end up in the hepatic portal circulation via that vein to the liver. And so the hepatocytes will then process all those nutrients and do something with them. So I just want to do a little quick list of what you already know. Always rely on what you know. You know so much more already about GI system than you think you do. So go with what you know. So the list of nutrients, basically, which is what we're going to be covering in nutrition. Why nutrition is such a nice thing. You just kind of go, yeah, and you just go through it. It's nice. Carbohydrates are going to be the saccharides that becomes, really, we're trying to get to glucose every time with a carbohydrate. So the sugars, monosaccharides, trisaccharides, disaccharides. There are polysaccharides, which are starches. We're able to digest those. We use amylopectin as a common carbohydrate, and we use amylases to cleave those. Fiber, we don't have the ability to enzymatically cleave those. The fiber has to be in the stool to bulk the stool so it makes it move. We also have protein. So what we're really doing here is just eliminating fibers, digesting starches, and absorbing all that pretty much as sugar and glucose mainly. Protein, flip that down to oligopeptides, polypeptides, di and tripeptides to amino acids and absorb those. Lipids come in these delicious flavors, fatty acids, triglycerides, which are three fatty acids, phospholipids make up cell membranes. A phospholipid looks like a triglyceride in a lot of ways, except that there are two fatty acid chains, and it's polar with phosphorus, and that makes it interpolate and make membrane proteins. Another lipid is cholesterol. We manufacture cholesterol in the liver. We're able to uptake cholesterol in the diet. We use cholesterol as part of bile for emulsification of lipids. We use cholesterol in cell membranes, so right alongside phospholipids. So I know I'm just kind of going a little bit, but we're going to go do all these things, and I want to have put these words up here so I can refer back to this kind of chart. So cholesterol also makes a lot of hormones out of that, the steroid, and so forth. And we have fat-soluble vitamins. So these lipids, when they get absorbed and how they're dealt with, is different because you get big oil droplet kind of things from them. The fat-soluble vitamins will go along with them. So the fat-soluble vitamins are AKED.
And the other vitamins will be water soluble, and the water soluble vitamins are B and C. Such a short list now that you know that, right? So the water soluble vitamins will be absorbed in a way that these other water soluble components are absorbed. So these get dealt with differently: lipid, lacteal. Everything else is going to go through that to the hepatic, to the intestinal venule drainage, to the liver. Nucleic acids, DNA, RNA, we cleave those down as well. Electrolytes then are basically ions or charged particles, charged molecules. So sodium, potassium, calcium we deal with, pretty important. There's phosphorus, chloride, iron. Think of those as kind of your electrolytes or charged particles. Minerals are organic molecules that we ingest, so those are really the B vitamins and C. When we think of that. Oh, I'm sorry, I'm actually putting these together in a way. There are also organic molecules, I should say, B vitamins, which are largely the B vitamins. So minerals will be more like our, there's a large list of minerals for nutrition, but maybe kind of put iron there. And then water, you have to hydrate. This is one of the things when you're putting a patient in the hospital, you have to make sure that you have dealt with water, and if they're able to drink or intake water, and how you administer that water. So that, consider that as kind of major. Okay, so we're going to talk about all this stuff that the liver does. I'm going to be using this word, these words, and I think it's important to kind of just see it in really that sort of clean form, I hope. So one of the things liver does is just deals with glucose. One of the organs that deals with glucose is the pancreas, but it's not really doing anything with the molecule itself. It's got the hormones going so that you can either pull blood sugar into the cells or put blood sugar into the blood so that you can maintain that blood sugar level. That was pancreas, that's insulin, glucagon. The thing that deals with glucose super specifically is the liver, and then all cells are going to uptake glucose. But the liver is able to make glycogen. So here's a picture of glycogen. I mean, just for what that's worth. But I tend to say branched polysaccharide, and so that's what I mean. These kind of linkages the liver can make so that you can branch it instead of having just linear, fibrous sort of polysaccharide. And so the liver can create glycogen, and it can break down glycogen because it has the enzymatic capacity to do that. So when you first are ingesting blood sugar or glucose, all the sugars are going to end up in the liver. The liver is just going to store what it needs. If it needs to store, it's going to do that. And that's going to be directed by glucagon and insulin, depending on all of whatever is going on. So glycogen projection and storage. Glycogenesis is to make glycogen. Glycogenesis is to make glycogen. Glycogenolysis is to degrade glycogen so that you can store glucose or you can release glucose. And lipogenesis is something else that is part of what the liver is doing. I have it here under carbohydrate metabolism because you can actually generate lipids from glucose. So think about, gosh, you want to so much. You're probably already been thinking about organic chemistry. But so it's just like this. If it's organic, it contains carbon. There you go. You don't even need that class. And so if it is not organic or carbon-containing, it's like an electrolyte. So if it's a vitamin, that's an organic molecule. A nucleic acid is an organic molecule. Glucose is an organic molecule. And so what the liver can do is take these, well, a lot of what happens in the liver and a lot of cells, what they're doing for a living is taking an organic molecule, some kind of carbon-containing molecule, and using it as a skeleton to make other stuff. And so one of the things that can happen in the liver is it can take that organic molecule, for example, the glucose, a pyruvate molecule, or just some other carbon-containing molecule, and create structurally some other organic molecule. There is nothing
magical or tricky about that? I mean, obviously it's magical because it's just, you know, you can't, it's, you've seen those diagrams. But I remember getting real stuck on stuff like that as a student until I would just went, okay, it's just not like, you know, salt. It contains carbon. And so there's a lot of molecular rearrangement. And then those words get like transaminase and acetylation and esterification. Okay. So if it's an organic molecule, how big is it? If it's super big, it's non-soluble. So it's kind of lipid. And if it's a smaller organic molecule, it's semi-soluble or soluble, and it's used for whatever it's used for. So that's what the liver is really just doing. It's just, figuring out, storing, spitting stuff out, doing all this. This is about carbohydrate metabolism and just dealing with incoming sugars. Whew, get excited about nutrition. Okay, amino acid metabolism. So I'm going through, you have to realize that part of GI system is adequate absorption of nutrients. And so you have that whole section of things, when things aren't working, what are people doing with them and what's the outcome from a GI standpoint. So amino acids are going to be coming from the proteins. And this is what I was talking about. Oh, collagen and it just goes directly into your skin. You know, it's not like that. You're cleaving it all up and you are just using the amino acids. So what does the liver do with amino acids? Well, it can make glucose from them, gluconeogenesis. It can use amino acid byproduct of the amino part, NH, the ammonia that you have as a part of just dealing with amino acids. Nitrogen, and you can detoxify ammonia, which is toxic, and make urea. And when the liver isn't doing a good job of that, ammonia gets high in the blood, and people have like encephalopathy and delirium and stuff like that. So this is why liver function gets so big, because when the liver isn't doing its thing, these things will be backed up in the blood, and a lot of them are toxic. And so you end up that showing up as symptoms. So that's why I'm going through this list in some detail here. So urea production, we talked about that, you end up then eliminating urea in the urine. So what the liver is doing is sort of detoxifying things by making them either less toxic or non-toxic, and you either get rid of them in bile, which is cute because that goes directly to the intestine. Remember, because there's that duct that goes to the bile. So you can eliminate junk there. Or just spit it out into the circulation and let the kidney deal. So elimination is happening. This is why kidney was hard, why renal was hard, because of elimination. And when things aren't right, you get too much of this or that in the blood or urine. And so over here, detoxification is going to be, if it's working right, you don't have too much built up in the blood. And so keeping that sort of really, I know you know that, but keeping that in mind, just kind of, you can just rule crap out that doesn't make any sense, you know? And I think what you forget to do so often, because I'm studying for recertification right now, I see what I do is the things that make me stumble then, right now, make me stumble now still, rather than just kind of going back and going, let's just go back to the basics of function. And that's, I'm not trying to sell you on physiology, because I know that ship has sailed. But I just mean you have more understanding walking into this program than you actually kind of do now, in a sense, do you know what I mean? Because you're lost in all this. So always just keep coming back and going, okay, if I have a lot of this, what organ isn't working? And even amino acid production. So we have non-essential amino acids and essential amino acids. We have to get all the amino acids in the diet. But there are some that we can actually generate de novo. And we take an existing amino acid and convert it into another amino acid. That's why we have essential amino acids in the diet, because we can't make those, for example. So the liver is just, it's so unsung. And it takes a long time until someone has liver dysfunction. Now, you will certainly see acute dysfunction. But when you get out there, I think one of the most stunning patients were the people with liver dysfunction. They were so ill. And they were so ill for such a long time. You know? Because I think I do anyway, tend to kind of underestimate the quality. quality of the liver. When it's working, it's just it's awesome, you know. And when it's not, things just get, people get really sick for a long time. Wait till you see ascites fluid. They're so ill, it's difficult. And if I don't mean to be making fun of them at all, I mean, you've had someone you've had in your family with liver dysfunction, but it's just amazing how ill people are for so long with liver dysfunction, whereas other organ dysfunctions are maybe, you know, a little more acute or something. Lipolysis is the, gosh, I just know you get excited about lipids. So lipid metabolism. So the majority of intake in lipids are going to be in this really triglyceride form and also phospholipid form. But we then maneuver between all the parts. So always just think of that fatty acid as a lipid. Is that fatty acid free? Or is that fatty acid attached to two other fellows in a triglyceride, or is it part of a phospholipid, or is it not a fatty acid at all, but it's a ring structure and it's cholesterol? So these are all the lipids, glucagon, epinephrine, and ghrelin, which we'll get to, can stimulate lipolysis, lipolysis, which would just be cleaving lipids. So let the word tell you what it is. So many enzymes are well named, and so many processes are well named. So lipolysis is the lysis of lipids. And generally, in that case, we think of releasing fatty acids, free fatty acids. Why would you do that? One, you can use them as organic skeletons to make other things. Cholesterol is used to make a lot of stuff, for example. Or, in the case of free fatty acids, we can use them as a fuel source as well. So, release of fatty acids, cholesterol from triglycerides, free fatty acids enter the circulation. That just means you clip them off and they're in the circulation. Little bits of them, when you break up fatty acids and end up with two carbon bits, those are ketones. And so glycerol can be used. I could keep talking about it because I get excited about it, so I'm going to just bring it down. So what I'm saying here is you're going, oh crap, I have to know that much for 16 questions. What I'm saying here is these things you really know, and we've talked about them, and the words are either go in one ear and out the other because you can't stand the word or the concept. But the truth is, it's simple. I'm trying to keep it simple so that you can remember these nutrients, because dysfunction goes to what all goes wrong. We had a lot of this stuff in the endocrinology section, I would think. So ketogenesis, stimulate the low blood sugar, ketones are two carbon compounds are released from the oxidation of fatty acids. So that's just a lipid thing. Those can enter a tricarboxylic acid cycle or Krebs cycle. And the ketone bodies that enter the circulation have the following names. I don't really care about these names, but you do hear people say ketone bodies a lot without ever maybe really identifying. There's acetoacetate, acetone, and butyrate. So when that's not functioning, or something's not being used well, you have them in the blood. And that's why when we're looking at liver function, you can palpate the liver, and you can cook the liver, and you'll learn all these things, that it's your lab chemistries that are going to tell you a lot about what the liver's doing. And you just look at someone, too. I mean, obviously, liver dysfunction is really going to show up a lot of times as jaundice, where you start to see it. That's exciting when you can just start to see it. You just start to see that someone's having a drug reaction and their eyes just look a little, they don't look bright, they don't look yellow, but they just, and you can go, I think that you're allergic to that, or that drug is causing you hepatotoxicity. It gets real exciting. So the liver shows up. God, I'm trying to sell you liver so hard. Lipid metabolism, fat soluble vitamin storage, cholesterol metabolism, we ingest cholesterol, we can make cholesterol de novo. What do we do with cholesterol? We use it in bile. We're not getting ready to talk about bile. Lipoproteins, which just means that VLDL, HDL, LDL, those are lipoproteins. So we forget what that word means. High density lipoprotein. Very
low density lipoproteins. When I say it makes lipoproteins, you already know that. That's those fat things. Plasma membranes, so that's phospholipid. Steroid hormone synthesis, I'm sorry, plasma membrane isn't, phospholipid doesn't come from cholesterol. I'm sure you caught that. Phospholipid comes from triglyceride. Plasma membranes use cholesterol, and so that's another thing. A huge amount of cholesterol is in the plasma membranes. Steroid hormone synthesis, so yay, estrogen, and yay, testosterone. Phospholipid synthesis is used, happens from lipids, from fatty acids. So where are phospholipids? They're in the membranes, it's in the blood clotting system, the arachidonic system, remember that arachidonic deal? That's coming from phospholipid, that's from synthesis of prostaglandins. And it's synthesized, I don't really care, but it's synthesized from intermediates in the production of triglycerides, because a phospholipid is a glycerol plus two fatty acid chains. So that's not so different from glycerol and three fatty acid chains. So it gets, how do you make membrane as you use that triglyceride pathway? Ah, freaking you out. Liver makes plasma proteins. And there are so many plasma proteins. I did the short list yesterday, and today we're expanding just a bit. But all the carrier proteins, coagulation proteins, complement, the immunology complement whole cooking thing. C-reactive protein, when you're measuring inflammatory processes and so forth, there are hormones that come from there. The apolipoprotein, which is the lipoprotein part of lipoproteins, or the VLDLs and all of those, that comes from liver. Liver makes all these carrying proteins that are binding globulins that carry hormones around and stuff like that. So all that is coming from there. And so it makes sense that when you digest proteins and you absorb amino acids, liver gets first dibs, because it is huge on protein production and supply of plasma proteins. So if this kind of makes sense, liver gets dibs on everything. And I think of it as kind of a trashy organ that, you know, gets all the trash and has to deal with it, but it really gets first dibs too. It gets to pick through the best trash. Liver function detoxification, so there's several things. There's cellular detoxification, which is having those Kupffer cells there, those sinusoids between the sheets of hepatocytes. The blood kind of slowly percolates or simmers through there so that you can do all this picking and taking and doing. The hepatocytes are just bathed in blood so that they can uptake all this stuff. That must be a really energy expensive organ. And yet, it's not one of the organs that uses the most oxygen. I mean, that's really, brain. It's quite a lot of time in my life. Enzymatic detoxification. There are these phase 1 and phase 2 proteins. Phase 1 proteins. Several of them, you've heard about this cytochrome P450, large complex of enzymes that do a lot of detoxification. And all that really is doing this to stuff, Sometimes you go, you transfer stuff, or you cleave stuff, or you bind stuff, you swap things. That's just what they're doing. That's what those cells are doing. It's all just based on enzymatic activity. You're either plugging it in a blender, the dishwasher, or the washing machine. I mean, it's just, there's not that many different things that they can do to detoxify those enzymes. So it's a big system. And you know that some, you really heard about it in drugs. Therapeutics of drugs is how do you get enough at the right amount, unaltered to the tissue and high enough concentration. That's the trick of pharmacotherapeutics, because you have to get past the liver. Could you absorb that? Can you even absorb that through blood, or does it have to go directly into blood? The delivery method. Wow, why am I so excited about pharmacotherapeutics right now? God, I'm feeling better today. Yeah. Aren't you glad? I was thinking I was 30% better. Dang it, I'm like 45% better. wow. So you get the drugs into the system, then you have to get them past detoxification. So you overwhelm detoxification systems so that you can get enough intact drug out of there. So you've been hearing about this cytochrome 450 UD's phase one program, a bit, these things from Dr. Latassi for months now, I'm assuming, right? So a phase two system is really esterification or compound. So to add, to esterify something simply means you add a big old chunk to it. Hey, meet Esther. She's here. And so really esterification really relies on so much is the kind of lipid process, the ester or acyl compound. I'm freaking you out, but all it is like a fatty acid, acyl, an organic compound. Acyl, acylation, esterification, adding a big old fatty acid to something. When you do that, you make something huge and bulky and it's not very soluble. When you de-ester it, take that ester off, and you make it easier to deal with. Anyway, that's just what those words mean. Don't let them freak you out. It's just add a chunk or take a chunk away. So the metabolites of detoxification or the products of detoxification are eliminated either in bile, directly via the colon, or circulate to the bile production. Okay, so here's something we really need to think about in terms of function of the GI system. So the liver is producing bile. It's doing all that other stuff with all the nutrients that get absorbed. It does something with almost, you know, all of that stuff. It stores it, fixes it, uses it, releases it, whatever. But something it does produce is bile. And so that's being produced, drains from the caniculi, canaliculi, that are at the section at each corner of that hexagon. Those drain into a variety of branches of hepatic ducts, drain from the right and left hepatic duct to the hepatic duct. And the hepatic duct will take bile, and it can send bile directly to the duodenum, or bile can kind of go retrograde up the cystic duct into the gallbladder. And then bile, really concentrated bile, can go from the gallbladder to here. So these guys, that is really just about, it's just about bile. And that's why it's called the biliary tree. And when there's congestion and stuff there, then you end up with backup of products in the blood. So bile production, hepatocytes do that, send it through the intestine. Look, half a liter to a liter of bile a day. That's just so much bile, isn't it? And the whole point of bile is to arrive at the duodenum and help emulsify. Bile will intercalate. Bile itself has a lot of lipid and will intercalate, make spheres or droplets or micelles out of blobs of oils and fats you've eaten. It's stimulated, the production of bile is stimulated by the hormone secretin, or secretin, as I say. I'm sure some people are much cooler to say secretin. It came from the small intestine. It was an enterohepatic production from the cells of the small intestine, secretin. It worked on the pancreas, and what would it tell the pancreas to do? Well, what would it tell the pancreas to do? The pancreas only does two things. It makes a couple hormones, or it makes some pancreatic juices. So don't freak out about what the pancreas should be doing. You make pancreatic juices because we're digesting. The other thing it does is tells the liver to make and secrete bile, and it'll tell the gallbladder to contract and release bile. The gallbladder is only storing bile as well. So that makes sense. Secrete stuff. Secretin says secrete stuff. And then the amount of bile salt that gets returned actually stimulates how much volume should be made, because some will get returned because you're dumping bile into the small intestine, and some gets returned with the other nutrients back through that portal circuit to the liver itself, and that has an effect on production of bile. Function elimination of waste, because some stuff that you've detoxified and made into a safer metabolite in the liver, you can just stick it in the bile and get rid of it. Or the main function of bile is then to emulsify fats.
Bile.
Emulsify fats. Fats, where'd they come from?
Well, there are these things, and they got absorbed into the lacteal, ended up in lymphatic circulation, and then end up in the liver.
So look, here's the hormone. We keep talking about it. Here it is again. Bile function, secretin, intestinal hormone, stimulated by chyme and duodenum. It comes from the small intestine. The appearance of chyme and duodenum will stimulate its release, especially acidic chyme. Stomach, it feeds back on the stomach and says, you can stop now. You're good. Because we're on. It's me. It's a relay system here. And then it tells the liver to make bile. And it tells the pancreas to secrete pancreatic juices, especially that watery alkaline juice from the center ACE in our cells. But if you just are unwilling to hear what I just said, okay. What is bile? It's 97% water. All right. Bile salts are in bile. What are bile salts? I hear bile salts. It just is one of those things that ticks me off, bile salts. I guess we know what that is. Well, it comes from bile acids. Bile acids are made from bile salts. And here's a little picture you can spend some time with. Or you can just go, okay. Bile acids are organic compounds. They're lipidy, they're cholesterol-y, and they're produced by normal flora in the gut, and we absorb them. Or we can make them directly, like cholesterol. This is really about cholesterol. Bile salts and bile acids. Look, it's produced by that cytochrome P450 system, just utilizing cholesterol. So, think about when Dr. McNeil talked to you, and you enjoyed it. I know, you just super enjoyed it. Remember that micelle, that lipoprotein, let's say, just like at an LDL. Remember it had a percentage of protein in it, it had a percentage of cholesterol, and it had a percentage of triglycerides. The cholesterol part of it is really these bile salts, bile acids. So that's all it is. Because we can use cholesterol, we can make cholesterol a little more soluble than these other things. Because cholesterol is sort of a switch hitter a little bit. We can kind of add stuff to it and make it carry a charge, make it a little polar, and then it can kind of get in there. And so it kind of wedges in these other deals and just helps break it up and emulsify it. It's not tricky. It really isn't. It's just cholesterol is a lipid that can kind of interact in both phases. It's the one that is the translator. I'll talk to you about it. It's an extrovert. So it is these bile acids are not soluble until you've added something to them that's that thing that helps it be soluble. And we call that conjugating them. Why we're all conjugating cholesterol right now. And you add the conjugate is either taurine or glycine. That shouldn't ring a bell. That shouldn't really mean anything to you. But there's their little pictures so you can see, oh, well, okay, I see a sulfur and an amine kind of group, and that nitrogen is existing in them. And nitrogen is just going to be something that will help the polarity or help it kind of get into lipids a little bit by just conjugating it. Conjugating cholesterols that we call bile acids makes them more soluble. And the whole point of bile is solubility of lipids. I hope that just didn't make your life worse. So look, when you've conjugated a bile acid or made it more soluble, we now call it a bile salt. That doesn't have to make sense. I still don't know what that means. Like acyl? Well, that's an organic chunk. I don't have to have a visualized picture in organic chemistry to understand that I have bulky things and I have things that are insoluble and I have things that are soluble. So we just took cholesterol, made it a bile acid, and then we conjugated it, which made it a bile salt, and that just means it's kind of soluble-ish. That's all right. So bile has bile salts. Those are cholesterol derivatives. You know, I really want to make things clearer. I never know. biocomposition. Yay, she keeps talking. So here's just a little thing to show you. Most of it's water, but what's that biggest chunk say that bile is made of? What does that blue thing say?
Bile salt.
Yeah, bile salt. Oh, we were just talking about that. It's a lot of bile stuff is bile salts. What's some of the other stuff? Other lipid things, mainly. Lipid kind of stuff. And also, bile has bilirubin in it. Bilirubin. Do you love it? Do you love bilirubin? Was that a Dr. McNeil lecture too? Oh, why are you giving me a dirty look right now? All right. So, spleen. No, we never talk about the spleen. Not really. In fact, I just texted the powers that be and said, have we talked about spleen? It seems like it's sort of out there. We talk about it in different places. But anyway, so look, there's a spleen. And so the spleen is having the function of uptaking the red blood cells. You know that. They circulate for about 3 days. And then you just recycle the bits that you can. And so macrophages in the spleen will spit these things out. So you get a hemoglobin broken down in three chunks. Heme, globin, and iron. And globin is protein. Heme is that porphyrin ring, which, you know, it just is. And it's the thing that was holding the iron. So mostly you recycle those things. You can use the protein as the amino acids. Use the iron as iron, or get rid of it. The heme then gets converted into bilirubin. I think this is like an English thing. It adds an E to the end of it. An English picture. So the spleen will spit out bilirubin. That is something it's done with heme. And that heme hasn't been conjugated, because we can change the nature of that heme by conjugating it, just changing it. And so if it is unconjugated, which is what the spleen is doing, the spleen is spitting out unconjugated bilirubin, which is what it does with heme. That's also not that soluble, because remember, just like the cholesterol, it got more soluble when it got conjugated. Whatever that was, it just was true that it got more soluble. Once you conjugate bilirubin, it gets more soluble. And so the spleen doesn't do that, the liver does that. So between spleen and liver, bilirubin is unconjugated. It's a little more insoluble. It's also, we call that indirect. The word indirect bilirubin isn't exactly a synonym for unconjugated bilirubin, but it does refer to insoluble forms of bilirubin. So between the spleen and the liver, it's indirect or unconjugated for all intents and purposes. Is that what I'm trying to say? Yeah. Then the liver gets it. What does the liver do to it? Well, it does what it does. It conjugates and adds crap to it and changes it. And then it becomes direct bilirubin, or more soluble bilirubin. It's less toxic that way. It won't get stuck in tissue. If bilirubin is kind of insoluble and gets stuck in tissue, what is the manifestation or symptom of that on a body? It's jaundice, yellowing. And so when you have a backup of bilirubin that's insoluble, especially indirect, you get it, it shows up in the skin and urine and stuff like that. But anyway, when you're able to detoxify that appropriately and switch bilirubin to something that is conjugated, you get rid of it in the bile. If it doesn't go in the bile and gets recirculated, you get rid of it in the urine. So it's going to be the thing that actually ultimately confers color to the urine or the stool. Did that sound easier just now when I said it than you've thought about it before? Because I think it's one of those things that I know when I'm studying, I see indirect bilirubin and I just go, I'm not gonna know. You know, I mean, it's just kind of, there's some certain things I just always reject, but you know, when you look at it in a simple form, it's not so bad. So if bilirubin, direct or indirect, is off, then you just know that something is wrong either with the liver's process of that, or there's more heme being broken down. So it's either going to be a splenic hemolysis issue, or it's going to be a hepatic dysfunction issue. If you just know the two organs that are working on it. So, that's what bile is. Bile salts are just cholesterols. Part of bile is going to also be bilirubin, which came from heme. All right, so, liver. Now, gallbladder and the biliary tree. Gallbladder is a muscular sac. Interior fossa, there's actually a little fossa on the liver. Do you remember that was so cool? And your liver was deflated probably when you saw it after that. Or there's like a little fossa that gets in. Now with the laparoscopic surgeries, heck, we just get rid of gallbladders all the time. But before that, that was a massive surgery with people had great big incisions. And you will run across some of those, like at the VA or something like that every now and then still. But to get up under there and open surgery, that was a big deal. You can just get in there and suck it out. Also, another one of those vesicular organs where you have, it can collapse into rugae or it can fill up and stretch. It holds 30 to 40 mils. So how much is in a, so how many milliliters are like in your 12 ounce bottle? Is it 255?
500.
Oh, 500. So 500 mils. So just, it's not a very large volume. How much is a shot? How many milliliters is salt? Is that? I don't know. Anyway, it's like a shot glass, though, right? Would it be about a shot glass? Maybe 31.
It's 1 ounce.
35 mils?
1.5 ounces and 1 ounce is 30.
So it's a shot glass. It's a shot. A fireball. You not know what that is. So here's your little biliary tree and a little picture. Anyway. So the bile can be kind of flows retrograde into the gallbladder. And all that happens, all the gall that thing does is it holds it and it absorbs water. And it will concentrate bile 10 times. So now what do we know is in bile? We've removed, 10 times the water from it. So we're left with a lot of cholesterol salts and some stuff. And so that's where stones can form. You can have precipitation and stone formation, very common. Is that stone going to sit up there, and when the gallbladder contracts under the stimulation of CCK, is that going to hurt? It does sometimes. Sometimes, just like a kidney stone, this thing can get down here and get stuck here. You can really, that's going to cause issues with the whole biliary tree and contraction and stuff like that. So you really we have a lot of cholecystitis in our country, and just it's an interesting diagnosis. So when it, all the weird things that you study, put those things you're going to see a lot right up there at the top. And then begin to deduce from there. I heard a doctor, you've probably heard someone say this, and I love it. When you hear, I don't know. When you hear hoof steps, think horses, not zebras. Has anyone said that to you? I love that one. You get quizzed on the interesting things that you're going to encounter. The routine things. Sure, understand those, and then you can add in the weird stuff. Weird, it sounds like a judgment call, but you know what I mean. So how does bile get released from the liver or the gallbladder? Vagal stimulation will cause weak contraction. Vagus was the parasympathetic side. It's rest and digest, so it would, of course, have something to do with that. The cholecystokinin directly from the intestines, so when food shows is dripping out of the stomach, kind, and entering into the duodenum. The intestinal cells themselves are stimulated to release their hormone to talk about the system and tell the stomach to kind of ease up, and then everything else squirt. Well, not everything else,
mainly the pancreas, the gallbladder, the liver, those intestinal endocrine cells. We need enzymes. We need emulsification. We've got food on board. So that makes sense, the intestinal phase. And that's what happens. And that is, OD is how you say that. It's OD. It's Schwinger of OD. I think I tend to say ODAD. Biliary secretion, the function of it. This is just repetitive. Now you know. Bile from the liver and from the gallbladder is released to the duodenum, stimulated by the presence of intestinal enzyme hormones, especially cholecystokinin, cholecysto, that makes you think gallbladder, that makes sense. And so, food's here, we need to emulsify stuff, because she ate fats again. Bile salts emulsify the fats for absorption. Remainder of bile is eliminated in the feces. And why do you want to emulsify fats? Because they'll form the big globules. Emulsification is to create, you don't change the amount of fat, you just put it in smaller droplets so lipases and other enzymes can work what they do, because there's more surface area, big glob versus lots of little globs. You know, think of your salad dressing. Okay, so this is what you've been waiting for, all the absorption of the nutrients. So really, all I'm going to do here is in this next section, because we have to absorb the stuff. So we did all the organs, all the transit through the tube from the oral cavity, esophagus, stomach, small intestine, duodenum, jejunum, ileum, colon, and then we talked about the accessory organs, pancreas and liver. So now, what are we absorbing? And it's really just this list. And this is where, in your outline, I included that list from the Ganon text, not so that you memorize that list. But I think it's important to look at it and remember the nutrients and what you're trying to get to, so that you just understand the function. And mainly, the whole deal is that the enzymes that work on the big molecule, the whole molecule, come on earlier in the scene. And as you chop it down, you get down to the brush border enzymes of the small intestine, they're really doing the minutia kind of clipping. So, you know, it's a lovely system. So carbohydrates, one of the things that you have to absorb, and monomer is a monosaccharide, glucose, fructose, and galactose are our main monosaccharides. We also absorb a lot of ribose from DNAs, so that's another sugar that's in there. Polymers are two, or more than one, so there are disaccharides. Now, I'm not saying know this list, because I don't care now. This is a nutrition list. But I just don't want to not use all the words, because you know how I am. But just wanting you to put saccharide with carbohydrate, and remember all the things. You're absorbing this, what are we going to do with it now? The liver's going to use up what it can, and then the pancreas is going to try to regulate that blood sugar. So you have the disaccharides, which come in the flavors lactose, maltose, sucrose, because you certainly will see lactose, and I just want you to understand that it's a galactose and glucose, it's a disaccharide. Lactose intolerance is common for everyone, unless you're really more of European descent that have that heredity. But the enzymes specifically are named for what they are degrading. And that's just my point there. Where does it come from? It's in the small intestine where you want the smallest bits to be arriving. Starches are glucose polymers. The number one in the diet is amylopectin. And you start doing that by using amylase, which is well named. Amylopectin is degraded by amylase enzyme. Salivary amylase is the first time you start working on that. So we begin to, if you chew something long enough, it would actually even taste sweet if it had complex carbohydrates in it. So you begin to even absorb glucose right there in the oral mucosa. So that's why it actually is useful to give someone who is having low blood sugar directly. They will begin to have oral absorption of glucose. From either it's going to be a simple saccharide that they're just absorbing, or amylase action on a starch. So it really is useful to drink something or have a candy that has glucose in it or something to increase blood sugar. And then there's also pancreatic amylase. So it's so important to get all the goodie we can out of glucose because glucose runs all the machinery indirectly through ATP production. So you have to have that fuel, and we really have a lot of sources of being able to get to it. The absorption for carbohydrate, which is really going to be a small saccharide, a disaccharide or monosaccharide, is going to occur in the length of the small intestine where all absorption occurs, or most of the majority absorption occurs. So here's the absorptive cell, the epithelial columnar cell that's lining those villi. And the apical portion is open to the lumen of that tube, which is always the case. And here, that's the lumen of the small intestine. And you kind of see this brush border, those projections of the plasma membrane of that cell. And so, glucose and galactose, so I specifically mentioned glucose transport and the transporters because you heard about these during especially the, you know, all the diabetes medications because you can aim at some of these. But anyway, these are transported into the epithelial cells by that sodium glucose transporter subtype 1. So there's a co-transporter, Symport, with sodium. To collect glucose into that cell. But I want to make the point that you don't stop there. You have to get that material to the other side of that cell so that it can get into that venous blood and make its way to the liver. And so you have, also there's a specific transporter for fructose, fruit sugar. But look at the basal side. So there you have that glucose transporter that will transport glucose out to the interstitium, which means it goes into the capillary flow, vein, liver. And so both sides. So it's an energy expensive tissue, like they all are. So it's going to use some of the glucose that it's transporting right there to drive all of this function. And these cells are in a tough environment, so it's a mitotically active tissue as well. So it gets turned over every few days. Proteins, the monomer, the subunit that you're trying to absorb as an amino acid. Where does it come from? Dietary sources. And you're sloughing epithelium because this is a tissue that gets renewed. So you're actually recycling your own intestinal lumen. It's cute. That's kind of cool. And then all those enzymes from pancreatic and intestinal secretions, those just get used as a protein source. That's the ultimate recycling right there. Protein digestion occurring in the stomach because you begin to have pepsinogen that is released from gastric cells. It gets degraded into the enzyme pepsin, which will act on polypeptides. And you begin that process of cleaving up proteins. In addition to just the acid disruption that occurred in gastric juices. And then those polypeptides will get degraded into smaller chunks over in the intestine with some things like trypsinogen will be activated to the protein digestive enzyme trypsin. Carboxypeptidases are also activated then by trypsin, so there's a cascade effect of one enzyme is being manufactured, and it can act and create active forms of other enzymes, so it's just a cascade effect. I'm not going to freak out about those details, but it's how it works. And that you get something big and you got to get down to something smaller, and you're doing that along the length of the small intestine. So that at the brush border, you're actually cleaving small peptides to create little amino acids that are individuals, or little dipeptides, or little tripeptides, right there at the brush border, so you can absorb them right here. And then we activate something else to chymotrypsin. So all those words you see on, when you look at the outline, they're all in there, and you see exactly what they act on, because it'll say protein, oligopeptide, polypeptide, tripeptide. And you just understand that you're cleaving up. My point I want to make to you is you're cleaving all the proteins you're ingesting down to amino acids and absorbing. So when you get to oligopeptides, which means short stretches, brush border enzymes are really doing that. So aminopeptidases, dipeptidases. Dyes and trimers are absorbed. You don't have to go all the way down to an amino acid, which is nice. So they're
peptide transporter subtype 1. It's also a symporter with protons. So it's kind of a proton pump that will drag in small peptides to absorb those into the intestinal cell. And then a lot of times, the intestinal cell itself will go ahead and cleave that on down to amino acids, and then those will get put over into the circulation. And where do amino acids go? Portal circulation to the liver for whatever is going to happen to them, and then distribution widely. Infantile protein absorption, the intestinal mucosa isn't there yet, and so there is endocytosis of big chunks, which is just kind of an interesting aside. And then these processes get on board. And so you see, digestive issues kind of in babies while they're still working out all this. They really don't actually have all those enzymes up and functioning yet. So, what else do we break down? Why we break down nucleic acids? Because not because we're going to intake DNA put it directly into our own DNA, our own nucleus, but we're just going to use the bits and pieces, and so we got to have those. They're digested into their parts. A nucleotide is a pentose sugar, a 5-carbon sugar, a nitrogenous base, and then there's some phosphorus, and you just cleave each of those bits off and use them. So the pancreatic nucleases comes from the pancreas. Nuclease means it cleaves nucleic acid, and the ribonucleases cleave RNA, deoxyribonucleases cleave DNA, love it when they name enzymes well, and then their intestinal mucosa nucleases as well, so you can just cleave all that up, and so you absorb the pentose, because it's a sugar, it's a 5-carbon sugar, and pentose, it's transported and taken up with the other sugars, and really it's going to be used, it might be used as ribose, it might be used as a, just any other organic skeleton. Make something else. Bases are absorbed by active transport. So you just take the step up. Lipids. When did I start? One, it's two. You can use your bladders appropriately.